In 1970, a television program debuted that changed the way millions of people looked at faith. The Hour of Power.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice.
Featuring the ministry of Robert Schuller, taught a generation that through God's love, your scars can be turned into stars. It was an idea that launched the most popular inspirational television program of its time. And today, the Hour of Power continues with a new voice for a new generation.
When you put your trust in God, nothing can stop you.
Pastor Bobby Schuller will encourage you and share a message that can give you a new perspective on life. Because whatever your circumstance or the obstacles you face, this moment can be your Hour of Power.
This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it.
Yes, and may you know today that you are precious to God, that He delights in you, and that the God of all things is jealous for you. Would you turn around and shake the hands of the people around you and say, God loves you, and so do I.
Okay, let's pray. So, Lord, we're coming to you with excitement, believing, Lord, that you can transform us, renew us, and change us into the image of Jesus. We pray, Father, that we would not leave here the same. We pray that as we leave, that you'd be glorified. Lord, we love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
may be seated. The Lord's words. We all stumble in many ways. Anyone who is never at fault in what they say is perfect, able to keep their whole body in check. When we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. Or take ships as an example. Although they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider when a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue also is a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body, sets the whole course of one's life on fire, and is itself set on fire by hell. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse human beings who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers and sisters, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. May we as the church continually strive to speak life into those around us.
Helpless estate and hath shed.
My guest today is Rabbi Jason Sobel. Rabbi Jason was raised in a Jewish home, and after years of seeking and studying, he found his calling as a follower of Jesus, or Yeshua. He was ordained as a rabbi by the Union of Messianic Jewish Congregations in 2005, and then founded a ministry called Fusion Global. He's the leader of two congregations in Los Angeles and Malibu. Rabbi Jason actively works to reestablish the Jewish foundations of the faith across the globe and envisions a future in which a deep-rooted brotherly relationship is restored among Jews and Gentiles. His goal is shalom, which means nothing missing, nothing broken. His first book is being published this year. And let's give a round of applause and welcome our friend, Rabbi Jason Sobel.
It's great to be here. Thank you.
Let's start with your beginning. How did you grew up Jewish. How did you kind of come to where you are today?
Yeah, I grew up in a Jewish family in the Holy Land, New Jersey, where there were more Jews than in Jerusalem.
Yeah, sure.
And went to Hebrew school as a child. And my journey really began. I was working in a large recording studio in New York City, looked at the lives of all these famous people, said there has to be more to life than just this, kind of began a spiritual journey. Then my best friend, who was not Jewish, called me on the phone. He said, Jason, could you tell the difference between the Old and the New Testament? And I said, sure. And he read me this passage. He was bruised for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. By his stripes were healed. He said, old or new? I said, that's new. He said, no, that's Isaiah 53, the Hebrew prophet. And I began to be provoked to jealousy and began to study. What did the scriptures have to say about the Messiah? So that's kind of a nutshell.
Yeah, sure.
The journey.
So you kind of have like a Jewish synagogue on Saturday for what you call like Messianic Jews.
Yeah.
And then you have what's the name of your church on Sunday?
Ascend Malibu Fellowship.
Ascend Malibu Fellowship, great. And then so you have this group that you lead. I mean, one of the first questions I just want to ask you is, you really want to see reconciliation between Jews and Christians.
Yeah.
And what do you say to some from the Jewish community or even the Christian community to say, why not just pick a side, you know, be Jewish or be Christian? Like, wouldn't it be better as a Christian reaching out to your Jewish community or a Jew reaching out to Christians? Why a Jewish Christian in this way?
Yeah, I think the simple answer is Yeshua, Jesus was a rabbi.
Yeah.
He lived as a Jew. Every major event in his life happened on a Jewish holiday. The Last Supper was a Passover Seder. He rose on the first fruits. He poured out the Ruach, the Spirit, on Shavuot, the same day the Torah was given. His disciples lived as Jews, and so we follow in his footsteps and do the same thing he did. But I think part of it, too, is I think there's something that unity does not equal sameness.
Yeah.
I think there's something unique that as a Messianic Jew, we bring a blessing to the Christian community and a blessing to the Jewish community. We can kind of serve as ambassadors to help both of them understand each other better.
And so you view yourself as a rabbi, and how does being a rabbi affect the way you shepherd, you know, I don't know if you, would you call it your congregation? I mean,
sure.
So the way you lead your religious community, thinking of yourself as a rabbi, how does it affect the way you view, you know, even the New Testament scriptures? The way you read the Bible, it seems like it would have a huge impact.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the beautiful things of what God gives us in the Torah is that it's very holistic in nature. So we talk about redemption, but for example, at Passover, you taste it, you smell it, you touch it. There's a sense of community. There's this, I think, a real sense of learning, but it's also not just information, but it's a real hands-on experiential type of learning. But I also think It's huge when you make the connection between the old and the new. It's like the road to Emmaus. They said that our hearts not burn within us. It's like, why is the first miracle Yeshua, Jesus, does turning the water into wine? Well, the first miracle Moses did was turning the water into blood. He doesn't come to bring death. He comes to bring life. Well, what's the sign of the new life? It's the wine of the Messianic kingdom. Why does Messiah have to die on a cross? We don't even, most people don't even ask the question. Well, the first Adam in the Torah stole something off the tree that we couldn't put back on the tree. So God puts back on the tree what we couldn't. Wow. Why does he have a crown of thorns on his head? Yeah. Because what's the sign of the curse of creation? That the ground will produce thorns and thistles. So he's taking that on himself to reverse the curse and restore the blessing. So making those connections and how it all ties together gets very deep.
Yeah, that's great, Jason. That's cool. Yeah, I mean, and of course, how are you doing? I mean, in regards to you reconciling seems to be a big, your big heart. And it's even true even with the Muslim community. I mean, it's that's, you know, the three sort of big monotheistic religions, Judaism, Christianity, Islam. Islam seems to be the one that's a little more like Judaism and Christianity because they share a lot of the same scriptures. And Islam seems to be almost outside. It's like the Samaritan for us, for Christians in some ways. And yet you've had some engagements as well with the Muslim community that have been really positive, right? Or
I mean, I think that, you know, the scriptures say, Hine matovim anayim shevet achim gam yachad. Behold how good and how pleasant it is when brothers and sisters dwell together in unity. And I think no matter whatever our religious beliefs are that might differ, we're called to love and honor and respect one another. And especially within the body of Messiah, Jewish and Christian followers of Messiah. And we've had some amazing experience with some Arab believers. We did an event in Detroit. There's like 30,000 people there. And a former Muslim terrorist got down on one knee before me and said, I want to love the Jewish people. And we had this moment of reconciliation where we declared Isaac and Ishmael coming back together. And the place just exploded out of that sense of people moved by how God was bringing and reconciling and restoring the family.
Yeah.
I mean, God cares about the Jewish people. He cares about the Arab people. He cares about Muslims, even no matter how radical you are. He got Paul on the road to Tarsus persecuting believers. God can touch people where they're at and do something radical.
Yeah, amen. You know, Jason, there's millions of people watching all over the world, and you seem to have such a great heart for people. What is it that you would say to them? If you just have one thing to say, what would it be?
Man, the Lord is in the business of transformation. And I think that he wants to meet you where you are. He sees more in you than you could ever see in yourself. And he wants to call that out of you because he has a hope and a future for your life. And God has a dream for your life and it's bigger than you can ever imagine. So I encourage you to maintain that hope, because hope is the belief that your future is better than your past. God wants to bring you out of Egypt into the promise and into the blessing through his son, Yeshua, our Messiah.
Amen, amen, that's great. What a great word, and I believe it. Jason, thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule to come and bless our community. And we pray we can be just one part of your redemptive work in the world to help bring different people together, and especially within the Jewish and Christian community. We love you and we appreciate all the great work that you're doing. God bless.
Love you too, God bless.
Hello, I'm Ed Arnold. My 60-plus year career in broadcasting has enabled me to come in contact with folks of tremendous influence and great visibility all across the country. I can truly say that regardless of where I go, everyone expresses to me their profound respect and admiration for Dr. Robert H. Schuller and the great ministry that he and Arvella established with God's help. Today, Pastor Bobby Schuller is continuing his grandfather's mission to bring the love of Jesus to a hurting world. Both Pastor Bobby and Dr. Schuller teach through their messages that the timeless words of Jesus are just as important, just as relevant, just as practical today as they were in the beginning. Dr. Schuller began his ministry over 50 years ago, and many people have not heard some of his early sermons. So today, we are happy to offer you this DVD, 2-CD set entitled Dr. Robert Schuller's Sermon on the Mount Collection, featuring 4 classic messages from the Hour of Power founder, Dr. Robert H. Schuller. Take a look at these timeless messages. From 1974, the greatest sermon ever preached, the Sermon on the Mount, given by Jesus himself more than 2,000 years ago. Dr. Schuller said the Sermon on the Mount was the only message that deserves the title of the greatest sermon ever preached.
Truly I say to you, as long as this earth spins in space, so truly God's word will stand strong.
From 1974, I am the American flag.
Be proud, be humble, be renewed. As I prepare to celebrate my 200th birthday, I have a prayer. Our Father's God, to thee, author of liberty, to thee we sing. Long may our land be bright with freedom's holy light. Protect us by thy might, great God, our King.
Tough times never last, but tough people do, from 1982.
If I had the money, I would buy billboards along all of the roads in the United States, all 50 states. If I had the money, I would buy billboards in the unemployed cities of America. And I'd plaster only one sentence: tough times never last, but tough people too.
And from 1996, a message that reached out to all ages, a possibility thinking lesson for a new generation.
It is a little six-line poem that sums up what possibility thinking is all about. Possibilities must be weighed, then priorities must be swayed, and plans must be laid, and commitments must be made. Then the price must be paid, and the course will be stayed. That's possibility thinking.
Strengthen your positive faith in God in a powerful and positive way today. Your DVD-CD set will include one DVD containing all four messages and a two-disc CD set, each containing two messages. Call today and pledge to give $30 a month for the five summer months, or give a one-time gift of $150 and help support the Hour of Power. Call, write, or go online and become a 2015 summer partner. The address is Hour of Power, Box 100, Garden Grove, California, or call toll-free 1-866-GET-HOPE. That's 1-866-438-4673. You can also go online at hourofpower.org. In Canada, the address is Hour of Power, Post Office, Box 9050, Surrey, British Columbia, or call toll-free 1-866-581-7654. You can also go online at hourofpower.ca. Now, let's return to the service.
Lord, we declare it is well. It is well with our souls. Lord, we praise you. Lord, you are the God of all provision. Lord, we pray over these tithes and offerings that they may be used in and through your church, in your kingdom, to do miraculous things, to bring the lost and broken into relationship with you, to let the world know that you love them, and so do we. Use these gifts as you see fit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Soul and and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we see, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring, and lives that death may die.
Wow, you guys are so powerful. Thank you, Tenore, for being here with us today. What a privilege again. So glad to have you back. Thank you. And thank you, Casey, for always moving stuff. Let's give Casey a hand. You know, everybody loves Casey. So he has to deal with some real serious high-pressure situations and just, you know, stuff that's not his fault, but, you know, everybody's looking at him. So we love you, Casey. All right. Well, if you're watching on television, we are so glad that you're watching. And actually, church, let's thank our television audience for joining us today. We're so glad you're here. If you're in the Orange County, LA area, or if you're ever visiting, maybe you're going to Disneyland or something like that, get down here. We want to meet you. Come experience this live. We'd love to give you a hug. We'd love to talk to you. Also at this church, the cell phone is holy. If you have a cell phone, we want you to pull your cell phone out, take pictures, post on Instagram and Facebook, and especially we want you to tweet. We love it when you tweet the sermon and the service. And if you're watching at home, my Twitter handle is @BobbySchuller. I respond to everyone at least once. Yes, it's really me. Yes, I am probably at the gym or at a fast food line or, you know, waiting at the doctor's office, but I'd love to meet you. So all right, today we are in the theme of creating a lead like Jesus culture. We want to have a culture here and a culture in every church across America of a community of people that lead and live like Jesus. And in order to do that, we want to take the next bit of time, actually going through my new book, Happiness According to Jesus, which is a commentary on the Sermon on the Mount. We want to use the Sermon on the Mount and the themes of Jesus' teachings to see what this culture would be like. But before we do that, would you stand with me yet again? We're going to say this confession. Hold your hands out like this as a sign of receiving God's love. And repeat after me, or with me, I'm not what I do. I'm not what I have. I'm not what people say about me. I am the beloved of God. It's who I am. No one can take it from me. I don't have to worry. I don't have to hurry. I can trust my friend Jesus and share his love with the world. If you believe it, say amen.
Amen.
All right. I'll begin with a question today. Can you remember a time when someone said something to you and looking back, you recognized that those words changed the direction of your life? Can you remember a time when someone said something to you, whether good or bad, That looking back, you recognize that those few, maybe even innocent words changed the course of your life forever. All of us have those kinds of words that something, someone said to us, whether it was a parent, a friend, a bully. There are all sorts of good things and bad things people say to us throughout life that continue to form and shape us, that actually impact in a big way the direction of our life. In fact, the words that you have listened to in your life, and especially the words that you treasure in your heart, form in large part the person that you are. Do you remember words that someone said to you that changed your life? I sure do. I can think of a bunch. I remember the time when I was in high school and I had no idea what I wanted to do with my life. And they needed a new president for the Christian club on campus, this little group. And someone said, you know, Bobby, you'd be good at that. I ended up being that president. And I see how it ended up guiding so much of my life to be a pastor. I think about the time at my wedding when my father-in-law, who is someone I deeply respect, you know, I had no desire to work at the Crystal Cathedral. And he said, you know, maybe there's a place for you here. Are you sure you don't want to do that? Well, that got me thinking about it again. And I look back and I go, those were critical words. I remember the things that people said to me that changed my life forever. When a girl named Hannah Presley looked at me in the eyes and she said, Bobby, I love you. I knew my life would never be the same again. And my kids, you know, most of us who are parents can remember that first time your child said Dada or Mama. I'll never forget when my little baby girl looked at me in the eyes and said Dada, my life changed forever. Because words shape us. The things that your parents said to you, son, daughter, I'm proud of you, or son, daughter, I can't stand you, or I'm so ashamed of you. Well, those things form us, don't they? They really do shape us. Many of you, you'd even say, you know what, my mom or my dad, they never told me that they loved me. Believe it or not, that lack of words, in fact, the other words that they said, in many ways, are probably forming some of you. And not all of the good words are the words that form us either. Many of us carry words that people said to us in high school, whether it was that particular girl, that nasty stuff she said about us behind our backs, right? Or that bully, or that nasty email you got. Some of you just got words a few moments ago or a few days ago, and you're still miffed about it, and it's forming the way you're treating your neighbors and those who are around you. You are the words that are spoken to you. And today, we want to talk about the value and even the danger of words. That words form who you are and form, in many ways, the world we live in. And we've become the kind of society that has made words cheap, that throws words around without intent, that words just get flung around and people are constantly being wounded, harmed, and hurt. We have advertisements constantly blaring at us. Words have felt even cheap to many of us who have been overmarketed to. And this must change. If we are to have a culture that is a live like Jesus culture, we need to not only learn to lead like Jesus, to heal like Jesus, but we also need to learn to talk like Jesus. You see, Jesus, when he talked, when he spoke, stuff happened. Jesus never speaks, even once, without intention. Jesus never just stupidly says something, does he? Every word Jesus speaks is with intention, and every word has power. Every time Jesus talks, something changes. Whether someone is healed, or someone is raised from the dead, or the weather changes, whatever it is, there's something powerful about the words coming from Jesus that are shaping and forming the world around him. And he continues to speak life into the world. Well, if we want to speak like Jesus, we must become like him, and that we too speak words with intent, and we speak words with power, and that we speak life into a dead world. Can I get an amen? Amen. Can I get a witness? You all know it's true, because all of us have been wounded by words, and those things hurt. They hurt, even when it comes from a crazy person, even when it comes from someone you know or love, and you know this person is clinically insane and everything they're saying has no merit, it still irks, doesn't it? Words are powerful, and if we want to talk like Jesus, we need to remember that Jesus wasn't the only one who had power, but he passed that power on to his disciples, that they too, when they spoke with intention, that when they spoke, things changed, things mattered. If we want to learn to talk like Jesus, who's better to talk to than Jesus' brother? The scripture reading today was from James. James is traditionally held, the book of James is held as a book written by Jesus' brother. And it's probably that this was actually not a letter, but a sermon that was written down and then sent around to the church. And in this sermon, James brings his Jewishness to the reading from today, which was James chapter 3. And in Judaism, words really, really matter. Of course, the most important words in Judaism are the words from Torah. Rabbis love to spend hours debating the meaning of a single word. What does this one word mean? How can we bring clarity to this one idea? And words are held in sacred esteem. The most holy word, of course, is the name of God, which is treated with such reverence. When the name of God in Orthodox Judaism is written down, it can't be thrown away. It has to be, you know, treated with sacredness. So words have value, and you see this theme, like you see it in Proverbs, you see it in Ecclesiastes, where it's like, don't just throw your words around, because words are dangerous and words are powerful. Ecclesiastes in Proverbs refers to the man that just talks and talks and talks as a fool. Wait, is that me? No, but that if you ever speak, it ought to be with a purpose. It ought to be with thought, with reflection. Proverbs says, even a fool who keeps quiet is thought wise by those around him, and even thought discerning by his peers. Because in Judaism, you don't just throw words around, but words are supposed to be protected because words are dangerous. James brings that idea to this passage, and he uses this example. He says, the word of God, it says, anyone who is not at fault in their speech is perfect, able to control their whole body. Whoa. Did you catch that? Anyone who is able to control their speech is able to control every aspect of their life. James says that the tongue or speech, it's a bit like the bit in a horse's mouth. We put bits in horses' mouths to guide the whole horse in whatever direction we want. So if you want to guide the course of your body and of your life, control your speech. He then says, well, it's also a bit like the rudder of a ship. You've got this gigantic ship with this tiny little rudder. And if you want to steer the direction of this ship, just control the rudder and the whole ship will be under control. So it is with your speech, with your tongue. And he says the tongue is like a spark that sets loose, and this is like, you know, this is the manly, you know, James, sets loose the fires of hell. You know, he says really in a way that your speech can be a spark that allows darkness and the work of the enemy to find its way into the world around you. It's not your fire, but it was started by you. You opened the door from your mouth. You actually get a picture of hellfire coming from somebody's mouth, destroying themselves and the world around them because of one word. Have you ever experienced a sort of hell in your life because of one word you said? I know I have. Aristotle said that one ill-gotten word is like a stone thrust from your hand. You can't get it back, even though it hasn't struck yet. Words are dangerous. And so James teaches us that, essentially, he says, you want to control your life? You feel like your life is out of control? Do you feel like everything is chaotic in your life? It's probably because of the stuff you say. If your life is out of control, get your speech under control. You're probably out of control because you said yes to something you should have said no to. Or maybe you said no to something you should have said yes to. Or maybe you just were telling it like it is. Many of us in anger or grief or hurry or frustration say things that we really regret. And then to add insult to injury, we get proud and defend those words later. And we watch as our whole life falls apart. You burn bridges with your words. You hurt people with your words. You damage your relationships with your words. One word can destroy your friendships, your reputation, even your whole life. Words are dangerous. Words matter. If you want to talk like Jesus, don't speak doubt and shame and anger and contempt and foul language into the world. Speak love. Speak life. Speak encouragement. Speak life into a hurting, broken world. The world needs your words. No matter who you are, you have words that have true power, and that's amazing. For Christians, I'm going to say this in two words. For Christians, words make. Words make. Words make. Words form the world around you. In fact, in Judaism and Christianity, we believe that the whole universe exists because God spoke it into being. Anything that is made by God exists because somebody said something. And in truth, anything that is made by man also exists because some man or woman said something. This building that we're in right now, someone somewhere said, you know, there ought to be a church building there. And it happened. No matter what you see that is made, whether it be made by God or man, exists only because first someone said it should be there. Words frame our ideas. Words frame our poetry. Words frame our praise and our prayer. Words form the world around us. In fact, words are the things that separate us from the animals. If there is any part of us that is divine like the angels, it is the words that we speak. You know, if cows could talk, I wouldn't go to In-N-Out as much. Am I right? I'd still go sometimes. Truly, words are the things that, in a way, make us more like God and less like the animals. Words have power, and words make. That's why animals don't really make anything, because they can't talk. Okay. So words, the words that you speak today, think of your words you speak today as paint on a canvas. The words you speak today are like, are as paint on a canvas. That as you talk, colors, shapes take form in the world around you. If you speak darkness and gossip and lies and bitterness into the world around you, your canvas will become increasingly darker. If you speak life and encouragement and truth and love into the world around you, you will live more so in that kind of a world. If you speak judgment into the world around you, you are going to attract judging people who will, by the way, judge you. If you speak gossip into the world around you, you're going to attract gossiping people who then, by the way, gossip about you. If you speak encouragement into the world around you, you will draw joy-filled, positive, encouraging people into your world. Friends, the words you say are as paint on a canvas. Speak life into the world. It needs words of life. The words that you speak are like seeds sort of flung around everywhere it goes, right? I mean, there's this passage in the Gospels where Jesus says that there is a seed and it falls on the road, and it falls, some falls on the among thorns, and some falls on the rock, and others fall among good soil. What if that were true of your words as well? I think it is. What if the words that you say, both good and bad, are like seeds that are sort of flung into the world around you, that you're actually planting seeds, creating for yourself the world in which you will live tomorrow? What happens when that one bad seed falls on good ground and takes root? Friends, the words we speak are dangerous and powerful because words make. And if you want to make a better world, you got to start with better words. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Words matter. Words ought to have intention. Words, and this is even more interesting. On Friday, I had the privilege of, and we have, I know we have people on both sides of the aisle here, right? But I had the privilege of hanging out with presidential candidate Ben Carson. And he was, we were talking, he was, this was his eighth time here. So he's an old friend of my grandfather's, won the Horatio Alger. But really, we were talking about his life and how anyone, no matter your background, he's a black American who was born to a single mom in Detroit, in poverty, and here he became the head of neurology at 33 at Johns Hopkins. It's amazing. Super genius. And we were talking about the brain, and he was saying that if you drill into the side of, this is a little dark, but if you were to sort of make an incision to the side of someone's head and activate, I don't know the name, I'm not a doctor, I'm a pastor, okay? This is part of the brain, that you activate this one part of the brain, someone could recite from beginning to end a novel they read 10 years ago. Your brain does not forget words. It represses, you know, it can become unconscious, but every word you've ever read, every word you've ever listened to, you store. Are you hearing me? Every word you ever understood, you store. That means words cannot be forgotten. Whether they're good words or bad words, they are in you, physically in you, right now. Words cannot be forgotten. Another reason why words are so dangerous. Many of us, we take these words and they're so painful that we repress them and bury them down. And what that actually does is make those words even more powerful in our lives because they begin to function in our behavior subconsciously. Yet to drum those words up is incredibly painful. I remember when I was telling Hannah a story about something someone said in passing to me when I was a child. And in my conscious mind, it was going to be a funny story. But as I started to tell this story, I began to weep. And I'm not someone who cries often. And I didn't cry. I didn't, like, break a tear. Like, I was crying so hard, it was hard for me to drive. It was probably very healthy for me. But that word, you see, that had been living in my life since I was 8. And affecting my personality. The words that you've said to your children, to your parents, to your friends, to your colleagues, and even to your enemies, if they heard those words, if they listened to them, they will never be forgotten. The words you speak will remain in the person, the object of your words, forever. And so I want to say this. Although your words that you're carrying with you can't be forgotten, they can be redeemed. And that's the good news. Because you can hear other words that have more power. The greatest word you can hear is from the Word of God, from this book right here. You know what this book says about you? If you don't, I encourage you to read it. In fact, I encourage you to saturate your life in it. In fact, I encourage you to spend every day meditating on it and letting these words get deep within your soul. Some of you say, well, I remember that someone said I was worthless. Or someone that I care about said I would never succeed. You know, I had someone in my life who always said I was clumsy. And you know what's funny about that? I really wasn't a clumsy kid. But whenever I got around this particular relative who would always say I was clumsy, I would, like, drop stuff and tip stuff over. You know, if you say the best about people, you draw the best out of them. And if you say the worst about people, you'll draw the worst out of them. The horrible words you've said about people will stick with them forever. And the encouraging words you say to people will also stick with them together forever. And so, friends, if you say, I got a tweet this morning from a man who said to me, my mother said, never told me that she loved me. And she said, you're the reason why abortion should be legal. Can you imagine hearing something like that from your mother? And yet some of you, you maybe didn't hear something that harsh, but you've heard hurtful words from your parents, your mom or your dad. Maybe they're still speaking those words to you, and they're gone. Those aren't words for you. You have new words. For those of you who say, I'm ashamed of my past, God says, you are redeemed, you are washed, you are forgiven, you are renewed. For those of you who say, I'm a failure, everything I do fails, I have no confidence, God says to you, you can succeed if you trust in me and never give up. For those of you that say, I can't control my life, everything is out of control, da 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 da, God says, trust in me. Don't hurry, don't worry, it will all be okay. Friends, I want to end with this thought. Everything you do in life is the result of words. And everything that everybody else does is in large part the result of your words. Become the kind of person who speaks life into the world around you. Don't boast about yourself. Boast about others. Don't exaggerate about your life. Talk and glorify the good works of other people. Glorify God in everything that you do. Speak praises. Speak prayer. But don't allow foul language or lies or conceit or gossip to come from your mouth. Don't discourage people. They have plenty of discouragement, trust me. Encourage people. See the best in others and watch as the world around you begins to transform into the kind of culture that God wanted when he sent the word into our world by flesh. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Please bow your heads with me. Friends, I want to invite you in this moment, if you have just shame and you have words that you're carrying in your life and you've seen how the pain and suffering of your life has caused you to spread words in the world around you that maybe you just didn't mean to, I want to encourage you in this moment to repent. Repent means to change direction. If you're here this morning and you want to make a decision to become a Christian, or maybe you're watching on television, I want to give you the opportunity. If you want to become a follower of Jesus, simply repeat this prayer after me. Father in heaven, forgive me. I have hurt others with my deeds and words. I have been hurt by the words of others. Forgive them, Lord, and forgive me. Redeem me to you, Father. Forgive me of my sin. Give me your Holy Spirit, I pray. And mark me for heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. Don't forget, 90% of people that don't go to church say they would go if a friend invited them. I'm just saying, it's your fault. All right, thank you, friends. We're so glad you came. I hope you leave encouraged. Speak life into the world around you and watch your world change. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
I'm so excited about a new book I've written. It's the first book that I've ever had that's been published. I've written other books that were self-published, but this is the one where Worthy Publishing took me up and said, we want to help you get this out to the world. I wanted to write a book that I felt like would change a person's life and even soul. And so this book, Happiness According to Jesus, is a book in which I write about the Sermon on the Mount and how it can change your life and the lives of those whom you love. Originally, I wrote the book for new believers who were saying, you know, I've come to faith in Christ. What do I do now? But then I thought, you know, this is something that every believer needs to know. And so I want to encourage you to pick up my new book. You can get it anywhere books are sold. Go to your local bookstore, order the book. I know it'll bless and help your life.
Join us again next week as Pastor Bobby Schuller brings you a message of hope on the Hour of Power. And when you visit our website, you'll discover books, devotionals, and other resources to take your Christian life to a new level. And Pastor Bobby would love to hear from you. Just write us. And when you do, consider supporting this incredible ministry on a regular monthly basis. We're taking a life-changing message literally around the world. And your regular financial support makes all the difference. Until next week, remember to let your hopes, not your hurts, shape your future.